So since you have this topic of CSR, corporate social responsibility, India, one of the first countries in the world to enact such a law in 2013, you all must know about it. But we should ask this question, why do we need CSR? Do we even need it? And if we look at history, in 1970s, the famous Chicago School economist and eventual Nobel laureate, Milton Friedman, wrote a very famous article in the New York Times, and that essay was called "The Business of Business is Business." And what he meant was, the only social responsibility of a business is to increase its profit. Is it? And should it be like that? Because unless we question this premise and have some kind of a position about it, it is fruitless to think about CSR and what we should do with CSR, whether we should do it, if at all we should engage in it, what should we be doing about it, etc., etc. We have to have this conceptual clarity about why should we have CSR. And Milton Friedman is an eminent person, one of the most well-known economists of the 20th century, and he said that no, the business shouldn't enter in any kind of such social activities, it should only focus on maximizing profits. And we need to understand and investigate this claim. Now, let's say if the purpose of business was only to make profits, and let's say business was successful in doing it, what would happen? The profits would increase, which would probably translate to an increase in GDP. Now, is that enough? Now, many of us who have studied economics either as a science or as a hobby know that GDP is an extremely inadequate and skewed measure of growth and progress. If you actually look at how GDP is calculated, what all it encompasses, one doesn't know whether to laugh or whether to cry at the process. It's a laudable effort and definitely better than doing nothing, but it's an extremely inadequate and skewed measure. And just to give you two examples, if the district where I stay, Gadchiroli, is beautifully forested, the most forested district in the state of Maharashtra, if the trees in Gadchiroli's forests are cut, the GDP increases. But what about the loss of environment? What about the loss of beauty? That doesn't qualify or quantify anywhere in the GDP calculation. Similarly, let's say if a person gets drunk with a lot of alcohol consumption, goes home and beats up his wife, and does this year after year, and eventually dies of liver cirrhosis. Because of his continuous liquor consumption, GDP increases. But the damage to his health, the damage to his wife, the damage to their relationship, the damage to their kids, this nowhere features in the GDP calculation. So, if the business does its job of only increasing profits, and if let's say that eventually translates in increasing of GDP, even then we can't be very sure that as a society we would be all right. Another metric, suppose business increases its profits, what would happen? Income or wealth of the people to whom the business serves, either its shareholders or the employees or the owners, whoever it might be, their income or their wealth would increase. Good. But if we look at the society around us, we'll figure out that this income and wealth distribution is very far from whatever we might call equal or just. And in today's world, it has become a serious problem. Because income inequality and wealth inequality also result in tremendous power inequality. And in today's world, where more and more things are up for sale, when more and more muscle power or any sort of power can be bought by money, having less income or having less wealth correspondingly means having less power, and then would also mean that you are left behind too far in the rung of social progress. If you want to know more about this, you can always read this beautiful book called Spirit Level by Richard Wilkinson, or you can also read books by another Nobel laureate, Joseph Stiglitz, to figure out what are the ills of economic inequality. If you look at the latest Oxfam reports, you would find out that just eight men, mind you, no more female in that group, so there is also gender inequality, but just eight men in the world, the top eight richest men in the world, had the same wealth as 3.6 billion people who make up the poorest half of humanity. And if we look at India, we'll find out that India's richest 1% have four times more wealth than 953 million people who make up for the bottom 70% of the country's population. This is a huge divide. This is unjust. And the resultant power inequality is going to damage our society. It is already damaging our society. So to go back to our initial premise that whether the business of business is indeed only business, even that's a questionable thing. And if we even assume that it's only business, then the increase in GDP or increase in income or wealth, because it's not equitable, because it's not just, because it doesn't take into account many of the other hidden factors, just doing that is not going to be sufficient. And that is a reason why, since quite a few years now, capitalism is in a crisis. And there is also an inherent effort within capitalism, even led by people like Michael Porter and on the other side, people like Muhammad Yunus, who are saying that capitalism needs a more human face and what is it that we can do about it. And CSR is one tool or one way by which capitalism can be made more humane, it can be made more reachable up to various masses of people. Now, the other eminent people, even Adam Smith, who kind of invented capitalism, or who we call the father of modern capitalism, whether it is he, whether it is John Maynard Keynes, another Nobel laureate and the greatest economist of 20th century, they never wanted capitalism to be so constrained to only few people. And they imagined a very different picture. They imagined a picture where everyone would eventually become well off, everyone would be happy, everyone would be content, everyone would be doing creative things and not get stuck with just drudgery. Why is it not happening? Why is it that our today's capitalism is bringing fruits to certain people? Obviously the billionaires and millionaires, but even people like you and me who are sitting here and speaking now, we are enjoying immense fruits of and benefits of capitalism, which is great. But if our lives can improve, why not the lives of everybody else? Something is wrong and we need to figure it out. We need to figure out a way by which capitalism can work for everyone. Only then even capitalism's true goal would be served. And that is an important reason why we need to think about social responsibility. Also the social responsibility of corporates and capitalism in general, and also the social responsibility of we ourselves as an individual. We cannot escape it. Most of you, I assume, would eventually end up working in various private sector institutions of India. And I think there is tremendous scope of working in the private sector and improving even the private sector. So I am not at all someone who believes that we should work only in the social sector or government sector. Although in my own life, after a brief stint with the private sector, I decided to venture into the social sector, and that's what I've been doing for the last 12 years. I definitely think that India also needs a very thriving private sector. And because most of you would eventually become some or the other sort of a leader in the private sector, I would urge you to follow a 5E formula, 5E, and I'll explain what those E's are. I'll urge you to follow that 5E formula wherever you go in the private sector. Ethics. We should be able to tell each other that it was a pleasure doing business with you. Unfortunately, in most of the private sector transactions that we encounter in our daily lives, whether it is getting into a rickshaw or whether it is buying something or whatever else, there is always a sense of suspicion somehow in India that samne wale ne thak to nahi diya mujhe. So we need to get to a level where private sector is built on solid foundations of ethics. Jhoot nahi, chalbaji nahi, corruption nahi. क्वालिटी में किसी भी प्रकार का झोल नहीं. सो एथिक्स. सेकंड इज एक्सलेंस. विच एवर सर्विस और प्रोडक्ट और थिंग दैट यू वुड बी केटरिंग टू, हाउ कैन वी ब्रिंग एक्सलेंस इन दैट सो दैट द क्वालिटी ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट, क्वालिटी ऑफ द सर्विस रियली इंप्रूव्स. थर्ड इज एक्सपेंशन. Various services and products that are invented by capitalism and distributed by private sector, why should they should reach to as many people as possible? So it should expand. If we look at the district of Gadchiroli, where I live, there is hardly any solid presence of private sector in this district. And I personally think it is also one of the major reasons for the backwardness of this district. only government is not going to be sufficient. Ultimately, it's the initiative of common individuals, common institutions, common firms that is going to help the society grow. Government is definitely going to play a part, social sector is also going to play a part, but private sector has a major role to play, and that's why expansion is also very important. But coupled with the fourth is equity. If the private sector comes with some beautiful products, beautiful services, life-saving services, things which can really improve quality of life and reduce drudgery, it should also reach the worse off. The usual logic of private sector is it will only provide services and products to those who can pay for it, who can afford it. And there is a logic to it, because private sector has to be economically and financially sustainable. So there is a logic to it. But if in the process of doing that, we accumulate enough, we should also see to it, how can we either modify the technology or the service so that it also becomes more affordable to people, or at least couple it with some kind of a subsidy or financial incentive, so that the principle of equity is brought in and drudgery should be reduced for everybody in the country. Why should only for a select few? So ethics, excellence, expansion, equity, and the final E without which we cannot go ahead is environment. We have to take into account the green dynamics. It's been 200 years that we have plundered the natural capital and converted it into material wealth. Probably it was necessary at that time, but now we're in the 21st century when material things are in abundance, but natural capital is eroding, environment is eroding. And this is probably the last decade that we have where if we take active efforts, probably we can still stop climate change and maybe reverse it. After this decade, after 2030, if we have not done enough, it might become irreversible. So wherever we go, whichever company you might go to get into, am I damaging the environment? Can I positively contribute to the environment? If it's a factory and if there's an effluent coming out of it, where is it going? Am I treating it well enough? All such sort of things, I think one should take into account so that we are responsible and we truly serve the meaning of CSR by being responsible also at an individual level and also at the level of an institution or corporate that we might eventually be working in. So that's something important that we need to understand. Otherwise, CSR should not be looked at just as a law that the government has enacted and companies have to comply with. That would be a very limited understanding of the whole concept. So today I'm going to also request you, and obviously there is no compulsion, but I'm going to request you that in addition to donating your time, also think about how can you spread the word. How can you spread the word, let's say about Nirman, to various other people in your vicinity? How can you spread the word and also contribute financially to social causes? Because even social cause needs money, and it's only through individuals' collective efforts that this money can be raised and social causes can deliver on their own promise. That is actually living the spirit of CSR.